Hello and welcome to this exciting session at the Zero Project Conference. My name is Samantha Dancy and I'm a Senior Relationship Manager at the Australian Network on Disability in Sydney. It's my pleasure to chair this discussion today on inclusive business strategies of multinational corporations. The goal of this panel discussion and presentation is to give various examples of how larger, complex organisations have managed to integrate the inclusion of people with disability across the whole of business and include people with disability as employees and customers, with a focus on models where an inclusive workforce and/or the inclusion of people with disability as customers makes good business sense. These examples will go beyond social sponsorship or charity and integrate into the business case. But firstly, for those of you who are not familiar with AND or the Australian Network on Disability, our mission is to create a disability-confident Australia. And we believe the best way to do that is through employers. The inclusion of people with disability is a whole of business imperative for employees, candidates, stakeholders, and customers. AND has experience working with large multinational organisations towards their journey of access and inclusion, including providing consultancy services, creating learning solutions, and participation in our programmes. We work with both large public sector organisations and private organisations, and those companies represent over 11% of the Australian workforce. AND is a member-based organisation, and our members are keen to increase access and inclusion for employees and customers with disability, and we have introduced a management tool to help them measure and report on their progress. What we have learned is that while there is support at the executive level, it is programs such as the AND Stepping Into internship program and the PACE mentoring program that bring practical exposure and experience to middle managers. Stepping Into program has made 758 internship placements since its launch in 2005. Our current summer cohort placed 93 students into meaningful paid internship roles, and our previous winter cohort placed 77. Interestingly, stepping into interns, when they graduate from university, record an employment rate of 75% within 12 months, compared with 71.3% of graduates without disability. For graduates with disability who have no work experience, the gap is 10% lower than their peers without disability. We are working towards closing that gap. Australia has introduced a national disability insurance scheme, which has brought increased focus to people with disability across Australia. So next, we will hear from our panelists today. We have a mixture of representatives from organisations and also from Nadine Vogel, who will be representing her clients at the organisation she works with. So first of all, I'd like to introduce Samir GADGIL. Samir is currently the Vice President and Head of HR at Wipro Business Process Services. Samir also heads the Diversity and Inclusivity Charter at Wipro. In Pune location for Wipro and is one of the trustees of Wipro Cares CSR initiative. So I'd like to welcome Samir to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so in next 8 to 10 minutes, I'll walk you through some of the interventions and practices which we have introduced in Wipro. But talking about Wipro first, Wipro is a large IT services company. It's an $8 billion organization having 175,000 employees worldwide in more than 60 countries across the globe. We have people of more than 90 nationalities working in Wipro. So it's indeed a very diverse work culture, global organization that we are talking about, and I have the privilege of leading the diversity and inclusion charter for this organization. Our diversity and inclusion charter really is weaving around these four broad pillars: gender, of course, persons with disability, underprivileged backgrounds, and nationality. Right now, I'll be really restricting myself for the persons with disability charter and not talking about the other aspects. We'll be happy to take on questions on any of those. The entire diversity charter is coming right from the top, has the executive sponsorship. There's a diversity council which has representation from the CEO of the organization, the CHRO, the chief legal officer, all are part of the diversity council at Wipro. We have our location SPOCs or location councils that we speak of. These are across multiple locations, and their objective is to really take the charter for entire diversity and inclusion in their location. So be it persons with disability, be it gender, be it nationality, or people from underprivileged backgrounds. And then we have a champion in each of these four tenets. So for persons with disability, we have a person bringing in the thought leadership, the direction, and carves out all the initiatives that we may want to run in the space of persons with disability. We started our journey on PWD close to about 8 years back, and we have really, over a period of time, not just matured, but also shown a significant impact. One of the things which I would like to talk about is this CREATE framework that we have. It's a busy slide. CREATE is an acronym. It talks about career, recruitment, how do we go about identifying people in with persons with disabilities in the markets that we have our presence in. How do we offer them a long-term career roadmap? So in Wipro, we publish all our positions internally. These positions are not tagged specifically for persons with disability. Any employee, be it able or disabled, can apply for any position. If a person declares their disability, we speak to the person about reasonable accommodation that we can give to make him or her compete with others doing a similar role. Our recruitment team is sensitized, is trained on how do we find people with disabilities, how do we interview and engage with them. Manager sensitization is a big activity which happens as part of our entire recruitment intervention. We have close to, in last 8 odd years, trained more than about 5,000 people in the recruitment team and the managerial population on this. Engagement. Now, having onboarded employees, having sourced them, and having brought them into our workforce, how do we continue to engage with them on an ongoing basis? How do we offer them meaningful careers and not just a job in the organization is a huge area where we see a lot of opportunity for a lot of creativity, innovation that we can do. And to really promote this culture, we came up with multiple interventions, and I'll be talking about those in my subsequent slides. Accessibility is another big issue where we have invested a lot in our facilities, in our IT infrastructure. Being an IT services company, there is a lot that we have done to make our internal workflows, our intranet portal, accessible to every employee. And now we have graduated to a technology that lends itself to be inclusive by default. So any new application, any new workflow that gets created in the organization by default is inclusive. Earlier, what used to happen was we used to create a workflow or an application, and then again invest time in it to make it inclusive. Now we have invested into a technology by default which lends itself to be inclusive. So any new application by default becomes inclusive. Talent transformation is the huge investment in the training function that we have done. I've spoken about it too in this earlier part. And enabling all these employees in various ways, be it with any devices that we need to have to make them successful. These are citations of or examples of some of our employees, a couple of them who are hearing impaired and visually impaired. They were hired from various schools and they are now holding managerial positions in the organization. One of them is actually part of my own team, the gentleman at the top. These are some of the pictures which I thought I'll show you around how do we engage with our employees. These are kinesics workshops that we do where we teach managers the sign language. We celebrate inclusivity and diversity through an all-hands meet that we have, where we talk about success stories, creating these success stories and promoting them in the organization is something that we do. We conduct these tours for persons with disability in our huge campuses that we have across multiple cities, where we engage with various NGOs, we get people with disabilities to visit our facilities, we give them a walkthrough of various roles that they can do. We offer them internships from 3 to 6 months. They, if they like it, they continue and we absorb them in these roles. The impact that we have created by doing all of this is we have now close to about 400 employees with disabilities. We have trained more, we have more than 50 policies which are made accessible. There are 120 internal applications which are being made inclusive, and more than 30,000 employees have certified in the online diversity and inclusion module. It's an online training program that that we have. Our vision is to really consolidate our pioneering work in the space in the country, and increase our footprint in the area of diversity and inclusion and have more and more employees being part of our workforce with disabilities. So that's what I had to share about Wipro and the practices which we have in our organization. We have won multiple awards and accolades globally and in India, and that's really it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Samir. It was great to hear about Wipro's whole of business approach and also the power of stories. So thank you very much. Next, I'd like to introduce you to Hector Minto. Hector is Senior Technology Evangelist for Accessibility at Microsoft. So welcome, Hector.
Good afternoon. Let me start my story with how I turned up here today. I think it's always interesting to know how do people get into this amazing subject of accessibility. 26 years ago, my mother, when I was a teenage boy, well, maybe 27 years ago, my mother said to me, Hector, can you come and help me run my adult education class? My mother is a learning disability adult education teacher in the UK, or was, and I, of course, said, absolutely no way. There's no way you will get me along to this. But she dragged me along, and from that day forth, I was absolutely hooked on the amazing capabilities, the sheer normality of people with disabilities, which as a young man, I hadn't previously been exposed to. And now I find myself at Microsoft to talk about something that my mother exposed me to all those years ago. For the last 20 years, I've been working with various assistive technology companies around the world, promoting the use of technology for people with severe physical disability, speech disabilities, and learning disabilities. In October last year, I joined Microsoft to take on a new challenge, which is to spread the word of accessibility to companies all around the world and to change the culture and make the change in Microsoft that is required to allow us to recruit, employ, and retain people with disabilities. I'll show you a quick video. Forward is which? Greenburn. I think I'm doing it. Can we play the video?
Microsoft inclusive hiring.
Microsoft's mission is to empower every person.
Buffering.
And every organization.
Maybe we'll skip that.
On the
I'll share it online with you afterwards through the
planet.
App. So the mission of Microsoft is to empower every human being on the planet to achieve more. This is something that Satya Nadella introduced to the company a number of years ago. The idea that Bill Gates first had was that we would have a computer in the office of every home, or on the desk of every office, and hopefully every home. And of course now we have a computer in the pocket of every person, and that's having a huge impact on the world. Not just that, the world is in a huge time of change in technology. There's this thing called the Cloud for Global Good, which Satya announced last year, which is the idea that technology is spreading further, quicker, and innovation is happening more rapidly around the world of technology as people move their businesses across to the cloud. Very quickly within Microsoft, we recognized that in every other industrial revolution, people with disabilities were thought of as an add-on and a tag-on later, and we've firmly believe one of the core values of Microsoft is that as we engage with businesses around the world in their time of digital transformation, that we must make sure that they consider accessibility and the needs of people with a whole range of people with disabilities. So Microsoft's impact should not just be within Microsoft itself, but within every single business that we engage with globally. Let me just move on. So my team, or the team that I work in, I'm the only person within the European accessibility team. I report into a team in Redmond where we have approximately 30 people, mostly with disabilities, who are working across a number of teams within the organization. So we have engineers who run our disability answer desk support desk. We have software managers, we have software engineers who are involved in the development of Windows, in the development of Xbox, in the development of the Office suite, and they're making sure that the disability voice is heard and that the existing technicians and developers within those teams are considering the needs of the disabled community. We also need to engage with the NGOs and the charities around the world to make sure that they're aware of our work and asking for the change that needs to happen. So a lot of the work that we do is in partnership with global NGOs and charities. We have our own inclusive hiring program, which we influence, and so we make sure that we're there as a rock within the organization for people to turn to consider what really does inclusive hiring mean around the world. A lot of things that happen in Redmond, we now have to kind of roll out across the world, and that's something that we're working very hard at the moment. You cannot talk about disability, though, without talking about innovation. We have been innovating around the world of disability for over 100 years in technology. Most of the things that you are very used to, voice control, touch screens, they all came to disability first. So it's really important that any company like Microsoft is really monitoring what's happening in the world of disability and technology, because those usable or those usability problems that are being tackled by the world of disability will be the mainstream product of the future. So I work across a number of innovation projects. I'm working with eye gaze wheelchair driving. I'm working with teaching blind 7-year-old children to learn how to code and how to create software. And these are all projects that we have time to work on and innovate with our research teams around the world. One of the most important things that we have to work on, though, is our readiness approach. This is the idea that we must empower every account executive, every technical account manager, every technical support person around the world to be able to talk confidently about disability and to be able to know what accessibility really means. And so about 2 years ago, we mandated accessibility training for every single employee at Microsoft. And as part of the onboarding process, everybody has to take the accessibility training to understand what change technology brings to the lives of people with disabilities and how the people within our organization are our friends, our colleagues, our family members. This is extremely important. One of the biggest challenges you all have in this room is helping people to understand what accessible technology really is. Embarrassingly, let me tell you this story. This is on camera, but okay, I'll go with it anyway. I've been working in the field of technology for 20 years, and I didn't know what alt text was until October, because I've been working with physical disability and learning disabilities, and I really wish I'd known about it earlier. So we've got a big job to make sure that we really understand what the technical capabilities are, or what the technical adjustments are for people with disabilities. So much of my work this year is to make sure that we're engaging with our markets around the world to learn to talk about this very important subject. The inclusive hiring program that many people will have heard about was our autism hiring program. The reason that we make a big deal about this, or that we talk very publicly about this, is that we firmly believe that, people with autism have amazing skills in design and bring completely fresh, neurodiverse ideas to our teams. They make our teams better. They bring ideas that our standard colleagues, let's say that the colleagues who come out of MIT, who come out of Harvard, maybe don't think about. They haven't had the same life experience that our employees with autism have. So we do talk publicly about that because we want to promote the very positive impact that people with disabilities have on their colleagues. And that's a message that I think all of us need to, are working on. I don't want to spend too much time on the recruitment approach, but it's good for us to have a showcase. It's good for us to have that idea that, you know, the autism sits there, but I wouldn't want you to think that we only employ people with autism at Microsoft. We have lots of people with physical disabilities and blind employees too. And the way that we would recruit them is by making sure that our engineering teams are actively on the lookout for those high-performing, high-caliber candidates, and we obviously try to get to career fairs and college fairs around the world, but in a call out to you all around the world, it's very difficult to find graduate fairs or recruitment fairs that are focused on the needs of students with disabilities. So please invite me to as many of those as you can. We don't have any specific idea about where people will work, but when you think about Microsoft, please don't just think about Office and Windows. Think about Xbox. I am extremely passionate about the needs of people with physical disabilities to game, and there are loads of innovations coming in Xbox. Xbox has screen reading capability built in. It's a games console with screen reading capability built in. We are working extremely hard on allowing kids with physical disabilities to game, so we now have partner controls so that children can play some of the controls that they can manage, but their parents help them with other buttons. You know, that approach only happens by having people with disabilities in those Xbox teams. That's the only reason those features exist. Whose responsibility is accessibility? This is another thing that we're working really hard on within the organization. Office has an accessibility checker built in. Before any of you send an email, write a PowerPoint, create a Word document, before you send it, in the top panel of the review panel within Office, we've just changed it, it's there at the top, is that you must check your accessibility. Check your spelling, and then check your accessibility. And before that document is sent out to anywhere within your organization, we will know that it will work with a screen reader. We will know that it's been checked, that everything, that every image has alt text behind it. Okay, so that's something that's happening within the organization. We're making sure that all of our colleagues understand what is a good accessible document, because in this world of cloud, you don't know where that document's going. That document could end up in the inbox of a blind employee at Wipro, at IBM, and we must not assume that your document is accessible without you checking it. So this is a big drive for us currently. I'm just wrapping up. The other thing that people don't recognize we have is two things, a disability answer desk. So anybody using assistive technology to access Microsoft technology gets free technical support globally from us. In America, we've got American Sign Language. We're working on widening that out further. But we also have an enterprise disability answer desk so that companies can engage with us and try to understand how they can make their workplace more conforming, more accessible, and to get advice on the tips and tricks to make their technology more accessible. I've talked about innovation. The inclusive design strategy at Microsoft I've talked about. Please don't just think that we're looking at disability as an accommodation within our technology. We know that by including people with disabilities, we make better products. So we talk about inclusive design a lot at Microsoft so that we look at people with permanent disability, situational disability, and temporary disability. So for somebody with vision, with low vision, our technology must work for them, but it must equally work for somebody carrying their mobile around in the sun. And so by developing a great low vision solution for disability, we will absolutely create better products for everybody. Finally, I'm just going to skip a bit of this because I realize we're against the clock. I want to just make sure you understand there's a new generation on the way. Okay, so we're very used to kind of certain disabilities in the workforce, but I just want to just quickly tell the story of these two. It's 1 minute. Becky is a friend of mine. I've known her since she was 6 years old. She's now 14. She's going to be on the job market soon, so please be on the lookout for her. She is top of her class in IT, and she can only use her eyes. So she is playing Sims. She's achieving above the level of her mainstream student. She's in a mainstream school, and she's coping with the curriculum all using an eye-controlled computer. Isabella is the first girl in Norway to get to school with cerebral palsy fully literate. She's got there fully literate because technology was given as an intervention early in her life. So when we think about people in the workplace right now, I'd really like you to start thinking about, you know, the different technologies people will have in the future and keep your eyes open for it. Oh, is it ready? If you've got time for the video, I'm happy for you to play it. Thank you.
Microsoft Inclusive Hiring.
Microsoft's mission is to empower every person and every organization on the planet to achieve more. We want to open doors for everyone. That includes people with disabilities.
Employees, high five.
There are 1.2 billion people in the world with disabilities. These are our employees, our customers, our friends, our family. We need to empower people with disabilities to come to work as they are, everything of who they are, to go for it. Whether that's building a product, a service, a website, or innovating something crazy that's going to reimagine the future for people with disabilities.
A screen reads Inclusive Design Toolkit.
People with disabilities have amazing skills. People with disabilities are a strength for this company.
A screen states Inclusive Hiring for People with Disabilities.
We need talent that really understands accessibility to drive innovation.
Ariel signs, hello, welcome to Microsoft's Disability Answer Desk.
Microsoft is a place where you can be who you are every day. And being who you are is the best skill that any of us can have. To learn more, go to Microsoft.com/inclusive-hiring.
The screen shows the Microsoft logo in high contrast, Braille, signed language, and the standard Microsoft logo. Inclusive hiring.
Thank you.
Thank you, Hector, and it was great that we actually got the opportunity to see that video, so thank you. Thanks for sharing your personal story and for the stories of Becky and Isabella as well. It does demonstrate the power of storytelling. And also a great example of how accommodating access is good for everyone, so including people with disability, but it's good for everyone. So next, I would like to introduce Beáta GAL-SZEKER. Beáta represents IBM Hungary and is the disability focal of IBM Hungary and is representing their current program on Ability 6 Skill Development Program. So please welcome Beáta.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Beáta GAL-SZEKER. And yes, I'm representing IBM Hungary ISSE, or Shared Service Center in Hungary. I'm diversity focal and also diversity project lead in that entity. First of all, let me thank you for the organizers for the opportunity that we can share one of our best practices regarding PWD hiring. Have you ever experienced that you were judged by your appearance, by the color of your hair, by your clothes, or by any visible disability? I believe all of us gained some experience about some level of prejudice and during our lives. And in that situation, we can realize that skills and capabilities are just relative. Let me share one of my personal stories. Besides my IBM position, I am a certified Hungarian Sign Language interpreter. And when I started to learn the sign language a few years ago, then I remember one concrete situation. I get at the beginning, I get really easily socialized with deaf people, and I was invited to a birthday party at a deaf person's house. And when I entered the room, the house, there was completely silence, and almost all of the people were signing intensively. And I really captured that, you know, I could not really understand most of the conversations. And then I felt that I was disabled at that situation. And these deaf people were really perfecting their sign language skills. So inspired by this experience like this one, together with our colleagues, we created a skill development program in IBM, which has the goal to change the common view on disabilities and instead appreciate the abilities. So, not a coincidence, this became our motto, focus on the ability and not on the disability. Business can only be as successful as the teams are that drive it. The employees of IBM represent a talented and diverse workforce. We strive to include people with different abilities, as it is originally declared in our Equal Opportunity Policy Letter in 1953. A key element in our diversity programs is the IBM's long-standing commitment to the principle of equal opportunities and conducting business with a view on creating a diverse and inclusive work environment. The company's global guidelines and values have a profound effect on our local culture and workplace policies. So no wonder that in 2011, a voluntary-driven project team was funded in Budapest in our shared service center with HR sponsorship in order to enhance the hiring of people with disabilities. Since the project start, we had many crucial milestones, such as exploring the hidden gaps in the hiring process, building up the partnerships with more NGOs, Hungarian NGOs, making IBM's workforce population more sensitive towards people with disabilities, and as well implementing two series of Ability 6 skill development program in 2015 and 2016. What is this program about actually, and how did we start? By 2015, our project team has conducted several interviews with individuals with disabilities who wanted to apply for a job at IBM. And our experience was that, among others, the most crucial development areas were the applicant's self-confidence, the effective communication skills to represent their own capabilities, or the knowledge how to prepare efficiently for an interview. However, most of them were really talented people with the skills to the specific job role. So due to the business and profit-oriented approach we have in our multicultural environment, on the important soft skills and conscious career-enhancing skills. We wanted to share this knowledge with external candidates. We wanted to share this knowledge with the candidates who are interested in the corporate environment, who would like to learn, who would like to develop, and who didn't have the chance to learn about this required, these guide standards. The most innovative aspect of our project is that IBM, as a profit-oriented company, offers this skill development program for external candidates, primarily to give the chance to develop themselves. Internal voluntary resources have been utilized for the implementation of the program, such as recruiters from the HR department for conducting sessions for this CV writing and interview techniques. Then in addition, trainers from various business units were conducting also other workshops, practical workshops in different soft skill topics like goal setting, self-management, communication strategies, conflict management, and so on. Also, managers and employees with disabilities were invited to every session to share their knowledge or their experience at IBM. We saw also that in Hungary, or IBM is located, one of our locations is Budapest, and our business language is also, of course, English. But for the Hungarian candidates, we saw also that English is a bottleneck. So it's important to give some opportunity to develop their English skills, which is crucial at an interview at IBM. So practice-based English language lessons were also held by one of our colleagues who has actually mobility impairment. To streamline information on relevant legislation, our NGO partner, Hand in Hand Foundation, offers a session about the Hungarian legislation about the registration of people with disabilities. So the name Ability Seeks refers to our motto, focus on the ability, not on the disability, and the number, the six, this relates to the six workshops we held in half a year period. According to our knowledge, no other multinational companies in Hungary offers such a structured program for external candidates, which operates by employees of the company on a voluntary basis. I just would like to show some pictures here to show that we have really a great atmosphere. The participants learned not just a lot of information, but also we had fun during the workshops. And at the end, I just would like to show you some feedbacks from the participants and also just briefly talk about the results. So at the end of the program, we received actually only positive feedbacks from the participants. They received positive reinforcement on their skills and abilities they could practice in situations related to multicultural corporate environment, and nevertheless, they built relationships with each other and with other IBM colleagues. We consider the increasing number of managers who are now much more open to hire a person with disability as a project success as well. The trainer team basically constitutes of six IBM employees who prepare the training materials and also deliver them on top of their job. The limited budget was used only for small humble catering and for some gifts for the participants. We also received a special award for this program. It was called Disability Friendly Workplace Recognition in 2015, which recognizes corporate best practices in the area of workplace inclusion. Last but not least, we supported the interviews at IBM, and also as a result, we hired 8 candidates of the 28 participants to IBM. Finally, I would like to thank for your attention, and if you have any question, feel free to contact me. And now, if you have just a few minutes, 3 minutes, I would like to now show the video about our Ability 6 program, which was for the first series 2015. And this was an internal video, actually, what we made by the project team. Yes, so if you can watch it then. One sentence that from the 3 candidates, 2 already hired to IBM. Thank you.
Thank you, Beáta. It was great to hear about your focus on ability, not disability, and how you've increased the disability confidence of your managers within IBM Hungary. So thank you. Our next presenter is Nadine Vogel. Nadine is the CEO of Springboard Consulting LLC, a global company working with national and multinational corporations, governments and agencies around the world to successfully mainstream disability in the global workforce, workplace and marketplace. So please welcome Nadine.
Thank you. I'm going to come down here because I'm too short, and if I stand behind that podium, you barely see my head. So thank you very much. Best practices. How do we define a best practice? It's different for every company, every industry, every country that you're in. So I find it an interesting question when someone says, well, what's the best practice for this or for that? Having said that, there are processes that have become best practices on a global scale that while you may take it and tweak it a little bit for your company, your specific culture, they work quite well. But before we do that, I want to think about a few things. One, when we talk about diversity and inclusion, let's understand that diversity is not the end all. Diversity is inviting someone to your party. Inclusion is asking them to dance, right? We have to prepare companies, we have to prepare all of you, that when you bring these folks in as employees, that you're not just inviting them in to be an employee, check a box, but that they're going to be successful and you're going to be able to retain them. That's asking them to dance. That they're not going to just remain in entry-level positions. They're going to have career progression like anyone else. That's key. So let's talk about what some of these best practices are. And the examples I'm giving you are ones that have been used by companies like Pricewaterhouse, Orange, General Motors, you know, Dell Computers, very large global organizations. So the first is understanding what it is you need to do. And the way in which most companies will do that today is by having or conducting an organizational assessment and gap analysis. What this is you bring together every senior level stakeholder of your company in one time, one room, one meeting, and you ask them to come prepared to share what have been their experiences, their interests, their concerns around people with disabilities. Has it been for one individual employee? Has it been for a whole team? What's worked, what's not worked, and why? Until you go through this process, it's very difficult to understand what your opportunities are, what areas of risk or weakness you may have. Maybe you don't realize that in another country, there was a successful initiative, two employees, it worked out well. Maybe you can employ that now here. So that's step one, so that you can understand what those practices need to be and the order in which you do them. Because in most countries that have quotas today, we're running to employ, we're running to recruit, but that's not the first step. You have to be ready. Number one global best practice is the delivery of disability etiquette and awareness training. I have deformities in both my feet, and twice in my adult life have used a wheelchair for about a year each time to get around. It is fascinating to me that people who know me, clients, who if they saw me last week and I'm walking, have a very different attitude towards me in conversation and the way they engage than when I come back 2 months later and I'm in a wheelchair. And I'm thinking, I'm the same person. It's fascinating. When you have a conversation with someone that uses a wheelchair, should you sit, stand, or kneel during the conversation and why? Do your colleagues know the answer to that? When we do focus groups with managers, the number one answer we get is that they would kneel down to the person in the wheelchair. But typically we kneel down to children. So is that really the most appropriate? And oh, by the way, if you're kneeling and you have bad knees, and you start to wobble, what are you going to grab onto so you don't fall on the floor? You're going to touch that wheelchair. Are you supposed to do that? No. When I talk about etiquette and awareness, that's what I'm talking about, practical applications. I'm not talking about anything theoretical. Because when you're trying to get managers to understand the benefits of hiring people with disabilities, you also want to know that they feel comfortable doing this. And the only way they're going to build that disability confidence is if they're first competent. So we have to give them those skill sets. Right? When you're recruiting, we hear from most of our clients that they have most of their recruiting is around college educated. We need folks with 4-year degrees. So we'll ask companies, well, where are you going to recruit these individuals? Well, we're either working with NGOs, or we go to these universities and we go to the career services offices. I can tell you if you're going to career services, you're not going to recruit people with disabilities. Every college and university around the world has something, and it goes by different names, but typically it's called a Disability Student Services Office. That's who you need to be engaging with, because unfortunately, the career services offices, we just had this experience just this last year in Brazil, in France, as well as in the States. The career services office and the disability student office don't talk to one another. And I will share a personal story. My older daughter, both my daughters have disabilities. My older daughter is 25. When she was in her last year of university a few years ago, she went to try to get internships and get jobs, interviews. She wasn't getting them, and she says to me, "I don't understand. The other people I know that are graduating at the same time are getting interviews." So I took off my Springboard hat and I put my mom hat on, and I went to the career services office and I asked the director what was happening with my daughter. And here's what he told me. He said, "Mrs. Vogel, we have to get our regular students' jobs first." I did not pay an irregular tuition, okay, but just like everyone else. But that is the mindset. That is the mindset. So we have to understand, if we really want to get ready to recruit and retrain and retain these individuals, we have to first go to the right place to recruit them. Right? You need to look at where you're doing that. And I know for time, I'm not going to be able to go through every best practice, but one other one I want to share with you is something called a reasonable accommodations committee, or reasonable accommodations process. When you're bringing folks in with disabilities, and I've heard a lot about visible disabilities, someone who is blind, someone who has a physical disability in a wheelchair, but what about people with learning disabilities? We don't see that, but they may need some types of accommodations. And when we talk to companies about reasonable adjustments and accommodations, what we hear is, well, no problem. When someone makes a request, we'll take care of it. We'll find out what they need. But the reality of that, when I convert that, is we scramble. Someone tells us what they need, and depending who they go to, it could take 6 months. We've had executives tell us at their corporations, and they have a disability, that it has taken months and months to get the reasonable adjustments that they need. So what a reasonable accommodations process looks like is something that is fair, equitable, and consistent across the footprint of your organization. Meaning, the way in which the person makes the request, to whom they make it, is exactly the same no matter where they are geographically, what disability type they have, what level in the organization they're at, or what function they work in. Typically, it would be something that would be on your intranet site. That form goes to a body. It could be a body of people, an individual. The same form, it's the same criteria. Most companies are setting up criteria that says, let's say if it's less than 500 euro, it automatically goes through. If it's between 501 and 1,000, it goes here. You can set up criteria that makes sense for your organization. But this way, everything is documented every step of the way. It is consistent and it is fair, including the timeline. From the time I make the request, how many days is it going to be till you respond? From that point, if I have to submit more information, how much time will it be till I am notified? How will I be notified? And then there are standard reviews to make sure that that reasonable adjustment is appropriate 3 months later. That has become a global best practice. But you want to have that in ahead of time. You don't want to wait until folks are coming in. Does this make sense? I hope. Shaking heads, yes, a little bit, right? So the thing is, do you have to have all of these things in place perfectly before you recruit the first person? Absolutely not. But you need to start thinking about it and have a plan in place, and that begins with that assessment process. But I want to take one step back as part of my closing to say the thing you do have to do before you get started recruiting the first person is, if your talent acquisition process is one that people come to your website, a careers portal, to apply for jobs, please make sure that portal is accessible. I shared a story with some folks yesterday that we had a global technology company that during their assessment made a comment that they really did not have a lot of people. They couldn't think of anyone who was blind in their building. And when we went down a few more steps in the conversation, it's because their own process, their own careers portal was not accessible. So how is someone going to come in if they can't apply? So there are many, many best practices like these, and I'm happy to talk with you one-on-one after the session. But I hope what you understand is at the end of the day, this is about organizational readiness to not just employ, but retain people with individuals successfully. And at the end of the day, your employees are also your customers. This is about your company's brand. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nadine, and thank you for describing the foundation blocks for any organization to become disability confident or to start their journey. So looking at your recruitment practices, are there any barriers to your recruitment processes, and also workplace adjustments? So are you able to seamlessly implement an adjustment to your recruitment process or for an employee who may acquire disability? So thank you, Nadine. Now I'm just doing a quick time check. So we have 10 minutes, so it'd be great to have some questions and answers with the panel. I would like to start with one question and then I'll throw it out to the audience thereafter. So this is to everyone on the panel, who feel free to jump in. In terms of the engagement of people with disability, so to achieve the successes that you've had, either with the organisations that you work with or your own organisation, how critical was it to engage with people with disability, either at the idea stage, so that sort of creation, implementation, or at your review feedback stage? So just be really interested to hear from you as to how you went about the engagement of people with disability.
If I may? Okay, so so at Wipro, one of the things which we did was our fundamental drive behind any intervention in the space of diversity and inclusion was our motto of nothing about us without us, and which meant that we would involve everyone in the organization, not just people with disability, but everyone in the organization, and welcome their ideas around how can we make our workplace barrier-free and inclusive. And some of the interesting initiatives which we actually ran in the organization came through this exercise. As a matter of fact, we also ran a contest internally on breaking all barriers contest, where how can we really come up with path-breaking ideas of making our workplace inclusive. So yes, involving employees really helps a lot, because no one person is a repository of every other best practice. And some of the practical interventions, as Nadine also mentioned, would come from people who have experienced disabilities in their life, either themselves or with somebody very close in their family.
Thank you. Hector?
So I've only been at Microsoft since October, but the thing that's really struck me is how confident the disability networks are within the organization. So, I've been kind of reliably informed that that's something that's evolved over time, but we have any number of specific disability networks on our intranet through our Yammer groups, including actually parents of children with disabilities. So, you know, we bring kind of real expertise to the table, i.e. the parents who are kind of dealing with a lot of the issues of living with disability. Over time, and actually I think as social networks have developed, and the idea that a social network is an important thing to have at work, people have become much more confident to talk about their disability, to raise problems and feel confident to raise problems about the things that are inaccessible in the workplace. But also I think what's happened here is the best practice in one part of the world has migrated around the world through the idea of using an electronic employee network. So my best advice is to find out who your superstars are and get them vociferous and vocal on the employee networks.
Great, thank you. Would anyone else like to comment?
Yeah. So when you conduct the assessment process, you should also talk to employees with disabilities and get their opinions. The one that sticks out for me in my mind is an organization that was talking about their facilities and for emergency preparedness. And the entire process they had to ensure that people with disabilities would safely be able to evacuate the building. That was until we talked to people who had to actually evacuate the building using wheelchairs and other equipment, and they said, some of them, they never heard of the process that we were told about. Some of them said, well, we tried it on a practice and it didn't work so well. So I think having that perspective is really, really important. We can think that we have a process in place that works well, but we have to talk to the people that are impacted by it to ensure that it's working the way we think.
Thank you. Beáta?
Yes, I just would like to also add exactly what just Nadine said, that as soon as we consider the aspects or what they need, what are their knowledge, I mean, how we could improve their capabilities, what kind of... So what should we really consider before we start a program or before we start a hiring? For example, in addition to this program, like Ability 6, we are also focusing on the hiring and the integration aspect. So like mentoring them, helping them to prepare for an interview as soon as they are closer to a position. So really giving them the chance what they really need. So not what we think they need, but really from their side, what are they expect.
Great, thank you. Now, I did see a few hands go up earlier on, so yes, a lady over here, if you'd like to just press the button on your microphone.
I am Ishita from India. It was really very informative, but what I want to know is that whether, because I work for persons with disability arising out of mental illness or intellectual disability, whether you have any provision in your organization for accommodating these people? And what sort of provision do you have? Because generally, when we talk with any companies, they do not know what are the needs, as you were also saying, what are the needs of these people and how you can accommodate these people? Because people who are having mental illness may have high IQ. We all know, or we have seen the film Beautiful Minds. So they might have high IQ, very functional, and how you can accommodate them.
Thank you. Who would like to take that question? Nadine?
So there are best practices today specifically around mental illness. One of the things I talked about was the etiquette and awareness. There are specific training programs now around etiquette and awareness of mental health and dealing with that in the workplace. Depending on the type and nature of the mental health that we're talking about, some accommodations have to do with shortened work days, breaks during the day. There are certain things where there's feedback loops. If someone gets highly stressed after certain meetings, that there's an 8-minute period after a meeting where someone can decompress with a manager or someone else to talk through what the stress was and kind of talk through the issues of that meeting. There's a whole litany of best practice accommodations specific for that disability type.
Thank you.
Soft, any feedback?
So I'm actually aware of only one case in Wipro where we have a person with a learning disability. And the good thing is the person works in a function and not in a business role. So the close supervision that the manager really offers has been of great help. The person does a job of planning for inventory of various units which we keep in stock, and we keep on replenishing as it depletes. So I'm not specifically aware of the reasonable accommodations that we have offered in that particular case, but yes, as an organization, we don't really have any such restrictions of not having people with mental disability in the organization, even though the Act was not really bringing this up in India until recently. Now it does, but certainly we are open to have people of any disabilities. As a matter of fact, we go beyond that and have even people who are disabled for a temporary period of time and need reasonable accommodation at the time of employment or even during their normal course of employment.
From mental illness, and then later on what happened, because of his hallucinations, he talked about his hallucination to his colleagues, and so he had no other way but to leave the job because the colleagues were not able to understand him. So in case of mental illness, I think the when we talk about recovery is nurtured by positive relationships with friends, family members, and also employers. So whether we are really equipped to do that.
I can add just a couple of comments. I mean, there are two things here. There's the acquired mental health issues through bipolar. Certain groups within the ERGs, what we call the ERGs, which are employee resource groups, the online networks, some are locked confidential groups and others are open, publicly open groups. And so for mental health, we have kind of strict rules about it being a closed group, so people can talk in confidence without necessarily having to declare to their kind of the wider colleague group. So that's one strategy that's been adopted. In terms of learning disabilities, I think it's really clear, as Pat was saying from Cisco earlier in the day, a lot of the roles at Microsoft for full-time employees are the best of the best, shall I say. I mean, I'm only at Microsoft because I know about accessibility. I wouldn't have got in any other way. I wouldn't have got in on my engineering or technical skills. I think one thing that we have to do there is influence our supply chain. So when we award contracts for the other things that Microsoft utilizes, over time, we need to start influencing that more and more to make sure that we're securing contracts with companies who share our core values. And that's something that Jenny, my immediate superior, believes firmly in. Okay.
Thank you. I am aware that we are at time, but I can see there is one more question here. So we'll open to one more question, and then I believe we'll be heading for lunch. So this lady just here. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Avital. I'm from Israel. I'm a high-tech veteran. And I'm very, very happy to see Microsoft and IBM doing such great things about inclusion of people with disabilities. And I was just wondering, are these local ventures or are there plans to distribute it, to duplicate it in other places? Israel will be preferred, of course.
Scaling is an issue for all of us. As much as we're telling the story of accessibility, how rapidly and how quickly we can affect change to global businesses is a huge challenge. But even within that, we have a huge challenge within Microsoft to take the learnings and best practice globally due to local legislation, the roles of local organizations. So if you look at the autism hiring program specifically, that's a very technical, creative mindset that we've looked at to bring neurodiversity to that project, whereas in a lot of other countries it's fundamentally a sales organization, and sales managers don't necessarily see the same advantages of recruiting people with disabilities when they have sales targets and all those other things. I mean, this is business, right? So what we're trying to do is highlight people who really want to work with us, or local Microsoft offices who really want to work with us to promote this subject even further, and then to highlight absolutely appropriate roles throughout the organization. Please don't think I'm saying for one moment that some of the best salespeople will not have disabilities. That is absolutely not what I'm saying. But
I'm more focused on R&D.
R&D, yeah, absolutely. I mean, and research roles. I mean, research offices are some of our best champions. I mean, the number of, if we ever find somebody with high technical skills to work in research, we snap them up. So yeah, give me your CV, I guess. So research, absolutely fine. But there aren't research offices all around the world, and many countries are kind of business-to-business sales organizations. So it's finding the right role to get the right people in post.
Thank you. Beáta, would you like to comment?
Yeah, I would like to just join Hector what he just said, that it's a big challenge to make this local program much more wider. However, we are sharing as best practice not only on this conference like that, but also internally to other IBM countries where IBM is represented. So, and in every country we have a diversity responsible. They have also projects, maybe not the same what we have, and I'm sure this is what we have in Budapest. This is something which is really much depending on the commitment of the people and the project team what we have, who have already some kind of experience with disabilities, and that's a start. So, because without that, without that knowledge, maybe we would just follow some policies, we would just try to do something, but we really need first experience and then engagement and.
The only other thing I would absolutely say is that we have a chief accessibility officer who sits at the top table at Microsoft, and that was a very deliberate decision that was made. When business managers from different countries see that we have a chief accessibility officer that's right up at the top, it sends a very clear message that accessibility is a subject they need to know about and to engage with. And that, over time, will have a greater impact.
Thank you. I am aware of time, so I would like to close the session today, and I'd like for us all to give our panelists a round of applause today. So thank you very much. Thank you, everyone, and I believe it is now lunchtime. Thank you.